Thanks for joining me today. Today we're going to be studying another of the names of God. Today we're going to talk about the name El Shaddai, S-H-A-D-D-A-I, God Almighty. It occurs 48 times in the Old Testament as a name perhaps by which the patriarchs knew God best. It's a name that's first used in Genesis chapter 17, a year before Abraham becomes a father. Read with me beginning in verse 1. Genesis chapter 17. In verse 1, when Abram was 99 years old, the Lord appeared to Abram and said to him, I am God Almighty. Walk before me and be blameless, and I'll make my covenant between me and you, and will multiply you exceedingly. Then Abram fell on his face, and God talked with him, saying, As for me, behold, my covenant is with you, and you shall be a father of many nations. No longer shall your name be called Abram, but your name shall be Abraham, for I have made you a father of many nations. I will make you exceedingly fruitful. I will make nations of you, and kings shall come from you. I will establish my covenant between me and you and your descendants, and after you and their generations, for an everlasting covenant, to be God to you and your descendants after you. Also I give to you and your descendants, after the land in which you are stranger, all the land of Canaan, as an everlasting possession, and I will be their God. El Shaddai. El is a shortened form of Elohim, God who creates and God who sustains. God spoke and the world came into existence. But not only was he able to create, he's able to control. He's able to part the land, part the water, and people walk through on dry land. He's able to make the sun stand still. He's able to raise his son from the dead. God Almighty controls. When we say God Almighty controls, we're not suggesting God can do anything. Now, as I pause, I'm not trying to say God can't do anything he wants to do. But he will not violate his nature. He cannot lie. And he will not violate his will. So, God can do anything is not completely accurate. But El Shaddai, God Almighty. Shaddai is a shortened form of Shad, which means breast, a reference to the female breast. To provide nourishment and provide sustenance. God is often seen as one who provides nourishment and sustenance with Israel. He often takes on the attributes of a mother nursing. You know, you can have all the money in the world, and you can yell as loud as you want to, but there's only one thing that's going to stop that baby from crying at 2 o'clock in the morning. It's going to be the nurturing of the mother. God provides nurturing. God's not a tyrant. He's not a despot. The pagans looked at their gods as someone that was kind of slap you around and someone that would just kill you. But when the Hebrews looked at their God, they looked at one who nourishes and one who gives life. And yes, even protected them at times. So when talking about God Almighty, we're talking about a God who's all-powerful and all-sufficient. One who gives sustenance, one who's the source of all of our blessings, all of our usefulness, and all of our fruitfulness. Well, what does that mean to us? First of all, it's a call to faithfulness. That's what it was to Abram. In Genesis chapter 17, as I said earlier, it's a year before Isaac is born. Abram's had to wait 25 years before the promise of an heir. He's offered Eleazar. Sarah's offered Hagar. They've had their plans and their strategies, but that doesn't work. Abram has now come to realize that Sarah is barren, and he is also unable to reproductively produce. He's realized his own insufficiency. And God had to give Abram time to learn about his own insufficiency and how God Almighty is all sufficient. And look at what it said in verse 5. No longer shall your name be called Abram, but your name shall be called Abraham. For I've made you a father of many nations. Imagine Abram goes back into the camp. He tells all the people there, listen to me. My name has been changed. No longer is my name Abram. Now my name is Abraham. I will be a father of many nations. They might have thought, well, he fell off his camel and hit his head one too many times. But Abraham has come to realize his own insufficiency. Abraham has come to realize that only God is all powerful. Only God is El Shaddai. So Abraham's got to make a choice. Will he will he acknowledge El Shaddai? The question is not, will Abraham believe in God? Abraham believed in God, but will he believe God? That's the question. You know, the world thinks the promises of El Shaddai are fruitless and faith and foolish. But when we see the power of El Shaddai, God Almighty, to provide nourishment and to provide sustenance, we realize he is all sufficient. Hold your finger in Genesis chapter 17 and turn with me to Matthew chapter 6. Matthew chapter 6. Look with me beginning in verse 31. Matthew chapter 6 and verse 31. Therefore, do not worry, saying what we shall eat or what we shall drink or what we shall wear. All these things the Gentiles seek. For your heavenly Father knows that you need all these things. But seek first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all these things shall be added unto you. Basically, what the Lord is saying, El Shaddai provides. Why then are we fretful? Why are we worried? Why are we anxious? He provides nourishment. He provides sustenance. He is God Almighty. Abram is no longer Abram. Now he's Abraham. Will he live like his new name? Will he live up to his new name? When we say the name El Shaddai, it's not only a call to be faithful to God Almighty. It's not a call to believe in God. It's a call to believe God. And if we say El Shaddai, consistent with the name. The second thing I think that's important is to recognize it's a call to fruitfulness. Look at what is said in verse 6. I will make you exceedingly fruitful. I'll make a nation of you, and kings shall come from you. Don't you see how the patriarchs handed that down to their sons? Look at Genesis chapter 28. Genesis chapter 28 and verse 3. Isaac is sharing this with Jacob. May God Almighty bless you and make you fruitful and multiply you, that you may be an assembly of peoples. But then Jacob passes that down to his sons. Look at Genesis chapter 35 and verses 10 and 11. And God said to him, your name is Jacob. Your name shall not be called Jacob anymore, but Israel shall be your name. So he shall be called Israel. Also God said to him, I am God Almighty. Be fruitful and multiply. A nation and a company of nations shall proceed from you, and kings shall come from your body. Did you see that Jacob had to learn the same thing that Abraham had to learn? Jacob went through hard lessons too. He had to realize that he's insufficient too. Jacob had tried to take a lot of things in his own hands. But now he's learned that he is insufficient and his name is changed. If you say El Shaddai, will we live up to the name? Will Israel live up to the name? But then further, I want you to look at chapter 48. Chapter 48, verses 3 through 4. Jacob's teaching this to his sons. Then Jacob said to Joseph, God Almighty appeared to me at Luz in the land of Canaan and blessed me, and said to me, behold, I will make you fruitful and multiply you, and I will make you a multitude of nations, and give this land to your descendants after you as an everlasting possession. And then look at chapter 49 and verse 22. Joseph is a fruitful bough by a well. His branches run over the wall. By the God of your father who will help you, and by the Almighty who will bless you, the blessings of heaven above, blessings of the deep that lie beneath. The patriarchs are telling their children, you're not going to be strong and mighty because of your mightiness or because of your weaponry or because of your number or because of your wealth. You will be a great and mighty people because of El Shaddai. El Shaddai will make you fruitful. El Shaddai knows our potential. I believe God rejoices and is made glad when he sees his children reaching their full potential of what he calls them to be. In Philippians chapter 1 and verse 6, it said, God who began this good work in you will complete that good work. But God who begins that good work in us completes that work so that we reflect his glory. God didn't give up on us. He came back and said, I'll work all the defects out, and I will complete that work. He is willing to work in our lives to make that happen. But as a call to fruitfulness, sometimes it comes to people who have been in the pit. 31 out of 48 times the name is used in the Old Testament, it comes in the book of Job. People who knew God as El Shaddai are people who had been in the pit. The God of the Bible, El Shaddai, will nourish them, provide nourishment, and sustain them. When we say God Almighty, El Shaddai, the meaning is not so much on the fact, not so much on the fact he can make the stars and put them in their place and hold them there, but it is that he is El Shaddai, God Almighty, God who nourishes and God who sustains. He can make our lives fruitful. He wants us to know as God, just as he's able to create, he's able to nourish and provide sustenance. A couple of things that brings to us in the end. We can't appreciate and understand El Shaddai until we, like Abram and Jacob, recognize our own insufficiencies. As long as we have the I can do it myself mentality, we'll never realize our own sufficiencies. Isn't that true of salvation? Isn't it folly to look at God and say, I can save myself, I can do it myself? We come to God for salvation when we realize we are insufficient and we are empty. It's only then that we can be made full. Only when we come empty, realizing our own insufficiency, can we realize that God will fill us up. I come empty. I bring nothing to the game. I have no merit. I have no worth. God, you are almighty. You are all sufficient. And you are able to provide sustenance and nourishment. What area of life is there that we have not given to El Shaddai, that we've realized our insufficiency? Is there one area of our life that we're not as fruitful because we've not come empty? Will we live up to the change of our name? Will we live up to the change of our name and realize El Shaddai, God Almighty? Well, thanks for joining me. And next time we'll continue with our study in the names of God and study another name. I sure hope this is helpful and beneficial to you. Thank you for being here.